In a recent video series of mine, I reviewed 5 different games from the Legend of Zelda series: Ocarina of Time, Majora's Mask, The Wind Waker, Twilight Princess, and Skyward Sword. If you're interested in my thoughts on these games individually, then I recommend looking at those videos, starting with the Ocarina of Time one. While I was replaying all the games, I got a better feeling for what the core problems of the Zelda series are, so I thought it would be a good idea to talk about these a little and put forward a few ways the series might be improved. Although the series has made some attempts to shake up the traditional overworld format, they've all suffered from one major problem: a lack of content. In Ocarina of Time, Majora's Mask, and to a lesser extent Twilight Princess, the grassy fields sitting in the centre of the overworld were largely devoid of interesting content and terrain. You could argue this is simply because the areas act as a hub for the other parts of the game, but these truly open spaces are the best shot these games had at emulating the feel of exploration of the first Zelda game. The very first Zelda game was the embodiment of exploration. Even the sword had to be discovered by the player at the start. If they didn't discover it, the game didn't hand it to them or halt progress any other way than with its difficulty. This totally open progression speaks to the core of the Zelda series, and the overworlds in the three-dimensional installments have failed to capture this as well as they ideally should. In general, most games developers today are afraid of their hard work going to waste, which is a reasonable concern. Games constantly take more and more effort to produce, so the idea of working hard on something that players may never discover is scary. I'd like to see the Zelda series push towards having more optional sections though, and I think this would provide more opportunities than they have currently. The puzzles, for example, in most Zelda games are pretty straightforward. They're almost always well designed for what they are, but they're more about making the player feel smart than actually requiring them to be smart. I think this section in Twilight Princess is a good example of optional content. This place is hidden in the overworld and features 3 ice block puzzles, which are harder than the one presented to the player in the dungeon. The designers can make this section as difficult as they want, because they know the player doesn't have to complete it. Similarly, there's the Savage Labyrinth in The Wind Waker, the Cave of Ordeals in Twilight Princess, and the Boss Rush mode in Skyward Sword. While Zelda games have almost always presented expansive worlds for the player to really dig into, the later games have never truly been able to replicate that sense of discovery that the first Zelda did so well. I think this is because even though the world is larger, more of it is mandatory. For a player to really get that sense of exploration, they need to feel they may have discovered something that most players didn't. This is really a mentality that the Zelda games can't be blamed for, but it's something they should take into account. It's less exciting to explore something when you know millions of other players have seen the exact same thing. Ideally, these optional areas would be additional content, but Zelda games are so lengthy anyway that taking a couple of smaller sections and placing them in optional locations rather than mandatory ones would improve the experience overall. The closest the series has come to replicating that freeform success of the first game is the ocean of The Wind Waker. The openness of the sea is refreshing, and the freedom it provides the player allows for plenty of opportunities for minor segments of the game to be done out of sequence, which is rewarding in and of itself. It's better for the player to stumble across a few Triforce charts themselves, because once they become the main objective, it feels more like completing a checklist. Skyward Sword is perhaps the best argument that optional sequences are important to the Zelda series. While it included plenty of stuff to do between dungeons, probably more content than any of the other games, the fact that it was all forced made it feel less interesting than it could have been. If whole sections had been cut out of the provinces in Skyward Sword and placed in the sky as optional extras, this probably would have felt much more rewarding. Unfortunately, the amount of content in the Wind Waker and Skyward Sword overworlds was lacking, even though the island concept is one which I still feel holds a lot of potential. I hope that Nintendo gives themselves another chance to make this work. Overworlds have seen a good bit of variety over the course of the series, but dungeons have remained fairly similar. Each dungeon is themed a certain way, and is usually housed in some kind of ancient ruin or temple. They're split into 2 halves. The first half sees Link progress through the place normally on the path to the mini-boss. Once the mini-boss is defeated, Link gains a critical item which can be used to solve puzzles or otherwise open the way forward. This opens the dungeon up a lot more than it was previously and eventually leads Link to the boss. In most cases, the boss is vulnerable to the item which Link just obtained. The dungeons are probably the most standardized element across all of Zelda, so it would be great to see this area of the series shaken up a bit more. Routine can be comforting in a way, but a break from it is usually a lot more rewarding. Mixing up the basic Zelda formula would go a long way towards maintaining player interest in future games. Although I think people are often too negative about the way the majority of these games deal with Ganon, Hyrule, and Zelda over and over again, I do think the series needs to move beyond this more often. Termina in Majora's Mask is a more compelling setting than Hyrule ever has been, and because it was a brand new area, it could be tailor-built in geography, atmosphere, and history to perfectly match what the game was trying to achieve. The handheld Zelda games often take place outside Hyrule, and don't suffer for it. Starting up a Zelda game has become a more and more painful process as time has gone by. Ocarina of Time suffers from slow tech speed, but it's actually a rather brisk intro when compared to later games in the series, specifically Twilight Princess and Skyward Sword, which take an incredibly long time to get the ball rolling. There's two elements at work here, tutorials and story. In Twilight Princess, the tutorials were taken to the extreme, where several were forced on the player in the first half hour of the game, with no way to skip them. There really needs to be an option to bypass these at this point, because it's boring to have to go through all this at the start of the game. Starting up a game, and then immediately being bored, isn't a good first impression. The story is perhaps a greater offender though in the later games. Skyward Sword features 38 minutes of forced cutscenes and dialogue before Link even gets his clothes. I don't have a problem with having a story in Zelda games, and I don't think it has to be completely minimized, but it draws at the start of the game so long that it sucks out all the enjoyment. Zelda games have never been about the story until recently, and the focus on these elements are damaging the games. Frankly, Nintendo are better game makers than they are storytellers, so the game should be the primary focus at all times. Ocarina of Time paces itself better than either Twilight Princess or Skyward Sword. Zelda games often start out in a similar way. Link lives a normal life, his life is disrupted, and the game starts. Ocarina of Time only disrupts Link's life a little at the beginning, however. It throws in just enough story to get the ball rolling, and it leaves the Kokiri village totally intact. The player is free to return there, and is in fact forced to return to Saria, before Ganondorf establishes himself as a real threat. This allows the player to immerse themselves in the forest village naturally, and it has a huge bonus of ensuring that the majority of the plot evolves around the player. In Twilight Princess, a lot of the action happens away from Link, and thus away from the player, making it harder to care. By the time the game has started, much of the story has already taken place. Midna has already been transformed by Zant, and Zelda has already surrendered. In Skyward Sword, Link follows Zelda around for much of the game, and it feels like the story is really hers, which would be fine, if not for the fact that we don't see any of it until the credits roll. While I think Ocarina of Time is a good template any future games in the series might follow, I actually think Majora's Mask is the pinnacle of story in Zelda games. Don't get me wrong, I don't think the main narrative is incredibly deep or anything, but it was told very well and stands out among the series. The real area it shines in, however, is its atmosphere, and the abundant amount of optional story for the player to find. There are miniature little character arcs that the player can discover in Clock Town totally at their own discretion, and while I loved every second of these, they have the extra benefit of not being forced on players who aren't interested. The NPCs are much more fleshed out than any other game in the series, and most importantly, the stories that happen over their 3 days in Termina always involve the player directly. Players are allowed to unravel the various narrative threads of Majora's Mask at their own pace, so even though it features a lot of different characters and events, it never feels like it's getting in the way of the core gameplay. One of the main pillars of gameplay in the series is combat, which is usually resolved using swordplay. Starting with Ocarina of Time, the series introduced the Z-targeting lock-on mechanic, which has been a staple of the series ever since. In Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask, it was a touch slow and imprecise, but later games have improved this immensely. Although there are sometimes some issues with locking onto the particular enemy the player might want, the targeting itself is definitely as good as it needs to be and doesn't need any tweaking. The combat remained very similar until the release of Skyward Sword, where swordplay got a major overhaul. There are those out there who love the new motion-controlled fighting, but for me it fell flat. I think it could be worth one more attempt to get it right, but it's the enemy designs more than anything which would need a major overhaul. As it was in Skyward Sword, they were all too much alike to sustain the entire game. I'd rather see the series return to the style of the previous games, with a traditional controller, because I think they never quite perfected the combat in this form either. Twilight Princess came the closest, giving Link a widely expanded skill set, but it stopped short of actually using these in the enemy designs. The Wind Waker's counterattack is a perfect example of what all the skills in Twilight Princess could have been, mandatory elements the player would need to master and utilize as the game went on. The stamina meter from Skyward Sword has a lot of potential as well if applied to combat, and I'd like to see the shield play a more important role than it has in later games, where it really felt like an afterthought. In the Wii version of Twilight Princess and Skyward Sword, the item use during combat felt very clunky, limiting the enemy designs even further and reducing variety. This is another reason why I'd like to see the series return to the traditional controller. The Wind Waker has the best in-combat item use of the series so far, and the dungeons in it were better designed to take advantage of it than most games in the series. The issue of using items in battle is directly connected to the button mapping and menu system. The worst case scenario when a player gets into a fight is that the enemy can only be killed or made vulnerable using a certain item, and the player hasn't got it equipped. While solving a puzzle, it's a minor hassle to equip an item most of the time. In combat, however, it seriously breaks the flow and disrupts the experience. The Wind Waker's dungeons were, in large part, cleverly designed in this regard. Usually when the player gets a new item in any Zelda game, it becomes so useful for the remaining duration of that dungeon that it's rarely swapped out. In the Wind Waker, enemies are often vulnerable to the particular item the player requires in certain dungeons. This means they're even less likely to swap it out, and the item gains more utility, vastly improving the flow of the game. This smart level design combined with the quick select menu from Twilight Princess would make for a very fluid experience. Interruptions are one of the biggest problems the series faces. The tutorials interrupt, the story interrupts, the menu interrupts, and control is often taken away from the player to highlight things. Spending 15 seconds using the Wind Waker to change wind direction gets old, listening to Fi spout obvious facts and random percentages gets old. Not all these interruptions can be removed, but they can certainly be minimized much further than they have been so far. The more the player is going to be running around, exploring, fighting and solving puzzles without coming across a stop sign, the more they're going to enjoy themselves. Skyward Sword in particular felt condescending in how much it broke up its gameplay with forced guidance, and it's hard to believe that this game came from the same company that produced Majora's Mask, which placed a clock over the whole game and punished the player harshly for poor time management. Difficulty is a particularly interesting topic for the Zelda series because it's spanned a large range now, with Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask being fairly challenging games, and the other three being much easier. Neither level of difficulty is inherently better than the other. The Wind Waker's reduced difficulty level suits its feel-good atmosphere, and the punishing nature of Majora's Mask suited that game. Twilight Princess was clearly trying to be one of the darker installments of the series, yet it refused to raise the difficulty back up from the Wind Waker. The low difficulty in Twilight Princess doesn't mesh very well with serious nature and makes me believe that the reduced challenge is here to stay. Instead, I think this is something that should be chosen to suit the style of the game. Another thing I'd like to see chosen to suit the type of game is the art style. The Wind Waker nailed this perfectly, overhauling the visuals of the previous games and producing something much more lighthearted. Although I enjoyed the Skyward Sword visuals, I don't think they added much to that particular game. It felt like a mix of the Wind Waker and Twilight Princess, but lacked the advantages of either. The impressionist effects did look beautiful in places, but overall didn't contribute much to the experience. For example, the characters were less expressive than they were in the Wind Waker, and the closed nature of the environments didn't give the impressionist effect the distance it really needed to shine. The style of Twilight Princess also worked to some degree, but it felt like an Ocarina of Time copycat, so suffered as a result. I think at this point it's fair to say the Zelda series doesn't have an established art style, and while the constant switching used to irk me a little bit, I think it represents a great opportunity for the series to use whatever works best on a game-by-game basis. I'd love to see Nintendo strike out with a bold new art style, as long as it adds something substantial to the experience in the process. Regardless of what type of game comes next in the series, there's one thing it needs more of: options. With the exception of Twilight Princess, Zelda games have been devoid of an option screen for some time now, and there's no valid reason why this should be the case. There's plenty of times the series could have presented the player with different control choices, but failed to do so. The bird in Skyward Sword, for example, can only be controlled using the motion controls, when an analog stick would have worked as well. Twilight Princess lacked the option to use a GameCube controller on the Wii version, The Wind Waker doesn't have any options to invert its camera controls, Ocarina of Time could have presented an option to change the Z targeting from hold to toggle, but it doesn't. I personally wouldn't even use all these options. I'd hate to control the game using a toggle version of the Z targeting, but it's very possible there's a lot of people out there who would prefer this. Usually these kinds of changes are easy to make, requiring only a few simple lines of code, so there's no reason they shouldn't be in there. Something else I'd like to see more of are the little extras that Skyward Sword brought to the table. The stamina meter, adventure pouch and upgrade system were all good inclusions, but could be pushed much, much further in future installments. Thanks to the upgrade system and pouch, there was an abundant amount of stuff for the player to spend their money on in Skyward Sword. Rupee sinks like the upgrade pouch not only give the player something worthwhile to spend their money on, but also help to increase the total number of rupees in the game. They're a surprisingly enjoyable currency to collect, so larger amounts are a nice thing. In the reviews I did of the series, I also identified a few little conveniences the games have introduced, like putting bombs into the bomb bag, or not wasting fairies if Link is on full health. These are the types of things which should always carry over to newer installments, and I'm sure there's even more little improvements which have yet to be thought up, even though they'll probably seem obvious in retrospect. There's a lot of elements common to most of the series, like heart containers, swordplay, dungeons, and minigames. Even though these can cause the series to feel a little samey, especially considering how many installments there are, the Zelda games are not afraid of change. Generally, each game introduces one major element which the other ones didn't, like time travel, transformation masks, or sailing, and I think these are an extremely important part of the series. Twilight Princess demonstrated what happens when the central element goes underdeveloped. The wolf form felt next to pointless, and although the game was solid, it emulated Ocarina of Time too much. There's no point emulating Ocarina of Time, because Ocarina of Time already exists. Ideally, I think each new Zelda game should introduce one new element to the series. It's been a wonderful way to avoid stagnation so far. That's not an excuse for including a poorly developed twist on the formula for the sake of it, something later games in the series have suffered from. I do love to see the series take risks, and I think it's something which should continue as long as the Zelda series sticks around. Sometimes the games are so vastly different from one another, it's difficult to know how to compare them, and it's perfectly reasonable that someone who hates Majora's Mask might love The Wind Waker, or vice versa. Rather than try to appease everyone, I think it's important to just take a new idea and run with it. If some fans don't like it, there's always the next game, which again can be radically different. There shouldn't be anything in this series which is too sacred to be examined and improved or changed outright. As long as this is the case, then there's no reason that Zelda won't be around for a long time to come. With all that said, I'm going to craft my own little wish list for what I'd like to see in a future Zelda game. Firstly, an overworld which is as large as it needs to be. Bigger is better, but only if it's not devoid of content. The overworld should aim to bring back that feel of exploration which was present in The Wind Waker, but without any tedious travel time. Warp points should be present, but not abundant. If warp points need to be placed everywhere, then that's a sign that travelling from one area to another isn't interesting enough by itself. A new setting is something the 3D installments really need. Even though The Wind Waker and Skyward Sword didn't really take place in Hyrule, on some level they felt like they did. Perhaps because they used the same old Zelda and Ganon setup that most games in the series do. It would be nice to have a change of pace and see these elements dropped, as they were in Majora's Mask, if only for one game. If Ganon has to be the main villain, then he should be established as such at the start of the game, rather than cutting in towards the end. There are still plenty of new directions Nintendo could choose to go with the series, but whatever they want to do next, they should do it well. The series needs to keep mixing things up to avoid stagnation, but there's no point including a central twist on the game if it's not well thought out. Since much of Zelda is very refined at this point, this is the area of the game which should see the most effort put in, and it should affect the game in a very substantial way. Modes of transport, and the theme of two separate but interlinked worlds, are also getting stale at this point, so it would be best to give these a rest. In later games, I get the worrying sense that the story is thought up first and the gameplay second. If only for the fact that the player is going to be playing the game more than they're watching the story unfold, the game should be the main concern. This isn't to say story elements are unimportant, just that they've cluttered up the series a bit at this point, especially the incredibly long intros. Nintendo should aim to have the player doing a substantial, uninterrupted sequence of gameplay within about 10 minutes of pressing start. The ability to choose a difficulty mode and skip tutorials at the start would be a huge benefit to experienced Zelda players. This also helps replayability. Although Twilight Princess is one of the most polished Zelda games ever released, it's not easy to replay thanks to its long introductory sequence. An option screen is also a must at this point, even if it's only a couple of basic things like inverting camera controls. This may only be a concern of mine, but I feel that controllers like the Wii Remote hurt the timelessness of the series. Until there comes a day when motion controls are really perfected and as reliable as a button, I think the series should stick with a regular controller. As I said earlier, the moveset of Twilight Princess, with better enemy designs, would be a good place to start as far as combat goes. I'd like to see every game stand the test of time as well as possible, and tight controls are a must for this to happen. I kind of hate to lay down a figure on this, but I feel like 8 dungeons should be the minimum for any Zelda game. 8 is basically seen as the standard, and as such, anything less than that is going to be inherently disappointing on some level. Additionally, since dungeons are the most similar aspect to all the games, I'd really like to see Nintendo think far outside the box on at least 2 of these dungeons. Jabu Jabu's Belly in Ocarina of Time and the Mansion from Twilight Princess are particularly memorable dungeon locations, but even this isn't enough. Something more than a reskin of the existing dungeon layout would be good. If they only try this on 2 dungeons and it fails, at least there'll be 6 dungeons left, which is plenty. The art style for the next game should be chosen to fit whatever the feel of the game is. As such, I think the game should be designed in this order. The main twist on the gameplay should be designed and prototyped first. At this stage, if the new gameplay element isn't fun, it can be thrown away and little work is wasted. Once they have something decided there, the story should be chosen to match up nicely with this new gameplay element. Once some of the basic story details are decided, the art style should be chosen to match what the gameplay and story need. It's also important that rather than trying to please everyone, Nintendo does with the art what they think is best for the game. The Wind Waker received massive backlash for its art initially, but it still looks incredible to this day, and will probably age much better than Twilight Princess or Skyward Sword. One more thing I want to ask for as a surprise. I know that must make me sound like a child, but hear me out. The Zelda series, with its mixture of old and new elements, is the perfect vehicle for surprising players. As long as the surprise is executed well, there's no reason players won't enjoy the break from routine. The biggest one the series has thrown at me in recent memory was the Sand Sea of Skyward Sword. While the Sand Sea didn't reach all its potential, its imaginative concept left me totally captivated, and was a real highlight of the game. I kept myself in the dark on Skyward Sword, not watching any trailers or any coverage of the game in the run-up to its release. I do the same for every Zelda game because at this point I'm probably going to buy it anyway. I was sad then to see when I did some research that the Sand Sea was publicized before the game's release. I imagine my enjoyment of that section would have been seriously diminished had I known about it beforehand. So to Nintendo's developers, I want to say surprise me, and to Nintendo's marketing department, I want to say don't ruin the surprise. The last question then is whether the game should appeal to a wider audience or not. My opinion, no. Personally, I really don't care if everyone out there can enjoy the latest Zelda and avail of all the endless tutorials explaining obvious facets of the games. It's just not something that affects me personally. If I was developing the games myself, I might have a somewhat different opinion. I might care more about people not being able to enjoy the game. Not every game can be made for everyone though, and there's nothing stopping people from playing simpler games and coming back to Zelda when they feel more comfortable with the medium. I start to care about this kind of stuff when the provisions placed in the games to make them more accessible start to hamper my experience, but as long as this doesn't happen, it won't hurt the game. With the ability to skip tutorials, turn off the in-game help, and higher up the difficulty level, this might turn into a non-issue. That said, if there was ever a time in Nintendo's history when it needed to win over its core audience, it would be now. The Zelda series has been around for a long time, and considering how long it's been around, it's remarkable how high the quality of all the games has been kept. Of the 15 main installments of the series so far, I can't point to any of them and say they're an outright bad game. I think some of the games are much weaker than others, but on the whole they're still enjoyable, and often offer something fresh. Based on the longevity of the series, the number of releases, and the average quality of all those releases, I honestly can't think of a series which comes close to matching Zelda. Sometimes I worry though that the series is becoming so mired in tradition that it will soon be a shadow of its former self. Zelda is always at its best when it's inventing things and perfecting them at the same time. In order to survive, the series needs to continue being improved and expanded upon in meaningful ways. As long as this happens, then I can honestly say that I'd be delighted to see the Zelda series stick around for another 25 years, and maybe even more.